Bye. This is at the entrance of Lions Creek Road and Stephen Lane. There are sediment control ponds. This is the beginning of the roadway past the undercut area. The undercut area is about 450 feet. We're looking from the Lions Creek side down Stephen Lane. Okay, this is the first turn in the road, again from Lions Creek Road. We're looking back now toward Lions Creek Road. Now we're looking into the sun right at the main turn. Schnackenberg's house, the original alignment of the road is right here. And this telephone pole stub pole is now going to be the new center line of the road. And looking in the opposite direction will be Mom's house, like this. It's now 3:59 p.m. It looks like they took off just a little bit early today. This is another sediment ditch, and they put wire around it so that children would not fall in. I'm standing now on Palisades Drive. Let's see, I'm just approaching the bridge, and on the left-hand side, there's a duck egg. Right there. And there are the three mallards that were on the island, male mallards. Another egg to the right of the bridge, in the same spot as before.
Oh, is that
right? Yep. It's right in this clump. Thank you. Hi, Abby. Hello, Abby. Hi, Abby. Come here, Abby. Come on, Abby.
Yeah, so why don't you let them do their own thing?
Because
I'm afraid they would all get eaten.
Yeah, because when we went down there, the first time when we found the nest, I saw an egg. It was just like laying there. We had a little nest and pretend it was getting a duck. I was like, well, if there's one egg laying around, you first
like break some more. That's what happened to my mom and dad.
It would sit on the beach every day, and each day it would go a little farther into the water, and it would green and smother. These other two ducks kept coming to visit her.
Conversation is about ducks.
Did you cry?
Hi, Baba. Jenny. How you doing, Eric?
Come over here. You didn't eat that.
We're going to get down there. It's going to be a big soul time on Harry.
There we go. That's a good boy, Steve. What do you got to say, Steve?
Hey, I'm Steve.
Hi.
Here's
There we go. Father and son.
Steve.
Hey, Steve.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Second painting in this grouping is by the same artist, Kumpel, and it is in the Chinatown section of Surabaya in Indonesia. These two sketches I actually bought from a street vendor in Jakarta. They are actually scenes, as I understand it, of villages on the island of Sumatra. In the bottom one, you'll notice that the women are pounding rice. And in the upper scene, the farmer is just gathering the rice. And of course, rice was a staple in their diet. The carving is just one of many, many, many carvings that the very talented people of Indonesia produce. They are very skilled in carving from many types of wood. This particular, I'm really not sure if it is a teak or not. The carvings that you see now are of a lighter wood. The one on the left is very tall, tapered, elongated. She's very graceful. It's also a very light carving. It's probably not terribly valuable one, but it has a great appeal from an aesthetic standpoint. The one on the right, however, is really a very valuable carving. You can see the detail is very, very intricate. I purchased it at a Catholic church on the island of Bali. The island, of course, is primarily Hindu. And that particular carving is a sign piece, and it is very clearly identified on the very bottom. This is a very fine carving of a Balinese male and typifying again the head adornment, a flower on the right side of his headpiece and his sword in the back and his draped garment. This is probably my most valuable carved piece. It is from the island of Bali. It is literally carved from one piece of wood, and it typifies the life of the island people in that they are bringing their offerings to the temple, and every compound within the island had its own temple, and then there was one main one. And if you look carefully, you will see the people bringing flowers and food. There are children. There are dogs, of which there were many on the island. piece, I'm showing, just to show the grace of carving of young women, of the island of Bali. It was not at all unnatural for them to be nude on top and graced with a beautiful garment in the lower part of their body. You will see a flower in both sides, both ears, above her ear, and the very long hair in many cases going beyond her buttock. The Indonesian men and women of Indonesia learn to dance at a very young age. It is part of their lives. This elegant crown that is painted in gold leaf was worn by a young Indonesian girl in a very, very graceful dance called the legong. Gamelan music is native to the island of Indonesia. This is a gamelan piece, and it is a gong that is integral to their orchestral orchestra. If you look carefully, around the center are all wayang types of figures that are also very important in detailing stories of the Indonesian people. This saber was also characteristically worn by the male, and particularly on the island of Bali. You'll notice that you had seen one in the sculpture that I mentioned of the male Balinese head. Of recent date, I saw a comparable artifact in the Museum of Natural History. This is a mythical style painting. It's a watercolor done by a very fine Balinese artist. When I was visiting the island of Martha's Vineyard some years ago, the little shop that I stopped at was selling a work by the same artist and for a good bit of money. So today it is probably rather valuable work of art. I enjoy it for its color and its style and the story that it tells, which so typifies the life of the Balinese people. This is an oil application on canvas. It looks very, very Chinese, but acquired again in Indonesia and probably Jakarta. It is a sign piece, as you will see on the top. And of course, many Chinese people live on the island of Indonesia, so in all probability, it was a fine Chinese artist, and it is one of two pieces that I have. I never thought of that before. This grouping of three works of art actually all done with bamboo. It is very, very intricate. The one on the bottom background is on silk. The top two are on a cloth background. The upper left hand, can't call it a painting, but bamboo piece is a woman pounding ice. And of course on the right is just a very typical picture of a village man carrying probably fruits and vegetables home or to sell at the market. In the lower piece is just a very peaceful scene of a village house and a sailing vessel. This charming piece is actually a painted coconut. When I was coming through customs, I brought back many, many things from the land of Indonesia and South Vietnam and Hong Kong and Cambodia. And when the customs official looked at this, he said, "That's it, lady." on the very last day that I was in Saigon that I heard about this very fine Vietnamese artist, and I went rapidly by rickshaw to his studio, and he had very few paintings left, none with people, but I thought this was very, very charming, and to this day I thoroughly enjoy it and the reflections in the water. It is done with palette knife, it's oil painting. His name was Lee Min, and he won first prize in a contest sponsored by a very fine art organization in the United States, so it is a valuable piece of artwork. This wooden jar was acquired in a little village outside of Saigon, and it was done and made in a very primitive fashion with tools that were from probably centuries old, and they just spun this and created this beautiful hand carved piece that I have never wanted to make into a lamp or anything other than just to adorn it with flowers. This is very fine pottery from Vietnam, probably Saigon. And you'll notice the intricate detail of people, again, in dance movements. And lovely tree and the birds landing on various heights. It's also a sign piece. This doll is from Thailand, and you'll notice the beautiful Thai silk that he is dressed in, including this beautiful scarf. It actually was an American gentleman by the name of Thompson that made Thai silk popular country and around the world. Back to looking at this doll, please notice the hand movement. It so wonderfully typifies a dance movement. Just see the back of the garment and how the pants are drawn up under the crotch to the waist. These are ivory figurines, something that I would never buy today. But at the time, we were not concerned about the poachers stealing the ivory from a precious elephant population. But if you look at the lovely detail, the female figure is one of the eight immortal Chinese characters, and she is standing on a teak base. The fisherman was really very special. He at one time had a rod and a little fish hanging, but my nephew, Donald Campbell, at the time, he kind of liked that, so the fisherman is now minus the rod and fish. These beautiful Chinese dolls I acquired in Hong Kong, and I found out that it actually was illegal to bring them into the United States at the time, so I liked them so much that I had bought a number of them for my nieces, and I kind of wrapped them up and put them in the very bottom of one of my two trunks that I brought home. But please notice how they dress, and that the color is as vivid today as when I bought them. And they're delicate little shoes that are actually in silk. But these are really very special and probably valuable today because they're in such fine condition. These prints I bought framed for my parents as a Christmas gift. I think I was barely working, very short time. I must have been maybe 16, 17 years of age, and these were on sale, and I thought they were rather nice, and forevermore they hung them in their home, and I continue to display them in mine. The scenes are probably the cozy New England village or a little town on Long Island. This clock my mom gave to her sister, Genevieve, and I bought it for her in Fortune House. Of course, she paid for it. It is a lovely Westminster chimes, and Jen enjoyed it for many years, and I only acquired it a recent date when Aunt Jen went into a nursing home, and the family asked if I would like it back, and I said yes. I almost forgot this magnificent hand-painted piece. It is actually a batik, and it was a gift from a Chinese family that I visited, and it was a custom in Indonesia. When you went, were entertained for dinner, instead of the guests bringing a gift, the hosts who entertained you were the ones who wanted to thank you for coming, and therefore bestowed their guests with gifts. If you look at the top of this particular piece there, again, there are the eight immortal Chinese characters. The three central figures symbolize wealth and wisdom and longevity. I'm never sure whether this is a lithograph or an etching, but whatever. I bought this at an art auction at Grossinger's, a very well-known resort in the Catskill Mountains. It was a frame piece, and when I bid on it, I bid low, of course, and it turned out that I was only the only bidder, so I was very happy to acquire this, and I bought it for my mother to give her son, because I thought it looked like one of my nieces, but she liked it so much she decided to keep it, and I said, okay, Mom, and someday then I would like to have it back, and I do, and I enjoy it. This lovely piece was done by a woman artist who studied at the Academy of Arts in Venice, and a friend of mine, and I met her in a little shop when we were in Rome. We were having lunch, and we started talking with her. So their shops were closed for their afternoon siesta, but she opened it for us, and I bought this, and it's in oil on, doesn't look like canvas, some kind of board, but it's a very, very pretty piece, and it was framed as it is. As you are about to see, are woven in rayon and silk. My mom bought them for me when we went on our trip to England and her first trip to Europe, and of course she was confused between the value of the pound and the dollar, and I'm sure they were very expensive, and I love them. They're from a collector's area, another fine example of jacquard loom artistry, which was perfected over 125 years ago by craftsmen of Coventry, England. These are mallets in flight, and again, the same silk woven artwork that I mentioned a moment ago. This is a porcelain piece. It's really very lovely that I had seen in this wonderful antique shop on West 57th Street, and my mom bought it for me for one of my birthdays some years ago. And the piece was a little damaged at the time, but it in no way detracted from the beauty of it. And we found out it was from an estate, and that this piece actually was used on a show on television. So this bird had some claim to fame. It is Bone China in Staffordshire, England. These are two four trays, again, that my mom bought during our trip to England. They are little serving trays. I find them quite lovely and nice to display and to serve with. These lovely arrangement of pressed flowers actually was made by my sister Dorothy Fernbach Campbell, and she did the framing, and I group it along with some other prints that also are framed with black background. Three plates I have found charming to put in my dining area. The middle of the three actually belong to my mother, and it may have belonged to her mother. It is a very, very old piece, and I wonder if the sketch is not by a famous child artist. I would like to know more about it sometime. The top one is part of a tea service that she had, and the very bottom piece is one that is Meissen. And I bought when I was in Europe. This lovely piece is from Germany. I think it's Meissen. I can just see the ducks kind of feeding in a pond. My nephew, Donald Fernbach, expressed a particular interest in this, so I guess someday he kind of liked that. And I enjoy it now. This hand-carved piece was made by Piet Schwank's grandfather, Johann Krebs, his mom's father, and it was given to my grandparents, and they passed it along to my parents and then to me. And it reads, "Give us our daily bread." This dining room set belonged to my mother. It looks like a little antique set at this point, and I thoroughly enjoy it. This is a Baldwin upright piano. It really is a very, very fine keyboard. It was one of the first things I acquired when I could afford to buy furniture. And instead of taking out a regular loan, I took a loan out on my own money and paid it back by the month. And I think I had paid it off in 1 year. He is very nice. Very nice. The chest belonged to my maternal grandmother, and my sister used it for doll clothes, and I subsequently used it that way, and now I keep my costume jewelry in it and thoroughly enjoy it, and it's a conversation piece in my apartment. The chair also belonged to my mom. I had it recovered with a batik fabric, and the piece that you see draped over the chair is another piece of batik, hand painted, that was a gift from an Indonesian family that I had met lovely people. This is a door chime that was made for me by my nephew Donald Campbell. It's really lovely. Just hear the delicate sound. I did not bring this piece back from any exotic island or place, but simply acquired it in an antique shop on West 57th Street. As you can see, it is Chinese, and I believe it is a very old piece. This inscription reads, "A consecration of the family to the Sacred Heart." My mother signed it on her wedding day, on the 9th of September, 1923, but for some reason, my father didn't sign it. These pieces, of course, have not displayed very nicely, but I just want a record of them. On the left is a lovely picture that belonged to my parents. It is very old. In the middle is an Aladro figurine that my sister gave me. In the back of that is a porcelain figurine that my mom gave me. It's a Royal Doulton. On the very right, you see the little guy with a headache. I bought him on the island of Bermuda. And in front of that is a bone china cup and saucer that was given to me by a waiter when my aunt and I went on the first cruise that I was on the Queen of Bermuda. This is a print that Piet Schwank gave me. It is of a West Highland White Terrier, and he thought it looked so much like Abby that he wanted it, and it really does. And he found this old frame that I found rather charming, so we just left it in it. This is Abby, probably on her first trip in the Palisades woods in Dunkirk. She was inquisitive and active and roaming and alert and having a wonderful time. And she's just perched on a log at the moment, as happy as can be. This is my most recent acquisition. When my sister and I attended the Washington Design Center recent date, it's the second time that I had seen this John Singer Sargent print in a lovely showroom called the Pugin. And it was framed so beautifully that I decided to buy it and put it in my dressing room area. This charming stand actually belonged to my mother, her bedroom set, and now is honored by the presence of my animals that are a few years old. The two teddy bears date back to my babyhood, and as you can see, they're a little worn. I saw one just like this little guy of recent date in an antique shop in Old Town, and they were selling it for $125, so I decided to put a lace collar on him. This little one my mom gave me when she thought that it was chic to give female executives a little teddy bear. This one, Peach Wank gave me, this beautiful Gund, on first birthday that we spent together. This Raggedy Ann was made by a woman at work, and I had given to my mom, and now I have it. This doll I got for Kathy Campbell, and you see the cute little freckles and red hair, but I kind of liked it so much that I still have it. That's it. This lovely piece was really a gift by a gentleman that we, meaning my parents and I, met on our trip along Route 1 in California before I left on the ship Hope. This lovely Ainsley vase was given to me by Peter Schwenk after a trip he made to the island of Nassau. As it turns out, the colors and everything about it working beautifully with my bedroom decor. I'd like to make one important correction, and that is the heart that was given to me was in fact made by my nephew Edward Campbell, who is the one who makes many things, including furniture, and he has also made me some other things. To conclude, the filming for this presentation was done by Peter Schwenk. I think he did an excellent job. And he was using his brand new Sony camcorder. The narration was by myself.
Okay, sit there a minute while I try the zooming in. Yeah, but the head is against that window. Move over a little farther towards the altar.
The chairs?
Yeah, so that your back... Sit in... Yeah, pull that chair a little bit. Sit in that chair a minute. That's a little better. Camera here.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Little camera.
Bye. Don't wear my name out.
Any good?
What about the Oreos? Oreos are good too.
I got two Oreos.
Hey, Sean boy. How you doing, buddy?
Did you drop that menu, Jack?
Linda and Walter are there. Hi, Jacqueline.
Jacqueline's playing with the mini. Made a bunny.
Want me to do it?
Yeah, I'm over here. I do it.
Who's that crazy dog? Who's that big boy?
Thank you.
making such a very special lady in this wonderful day for Brian. Lord, that the praises of all our hearts this day and to begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The love of God our Father, and the grace of Jesus Christ, his Son, and the peace of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious, loving Father, you have made the bond of marriage a holy mystery, a symbol of the love of Christ for his bride, the Church. Hear our prayers this afternoon for Brian and Cindy. With faith in you and in each other, they pledge their love today. May their lives always bear witness to the reality of that love. And we who love them ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, risen now from the dead, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
If I should be seated, that is for listening to the readings from the Scriptures.
A reading from the Song of Songs. Hark, my lover, here he comes, springing across the mountains, leaping across the hills. My lover is like a gazelle or a young stag. Here he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, peering through the lattices. My lover speaks. He says to me, "Arise, my beloved, my beautiful one, and come." Though my dove in the clefts of the rock, in the secret recesses of the cliff, let me see you, let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and you are lovely. My lover belongs to me and I to him. He said to me, "Set me as a seal on your heart, as a seal on your arm, for stern as death is love, relentless as the nether world is devotion. Its flames are a blazing fire. Deep waters cannot quench love, nor floods sweep it away." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
themselves with heartfelt mercy, with kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another. Forgive whatever grievances you have against one another. Forgive as the Lord has forgiven you. Over all these virtues, put on love, which binds the rest together and makes them perfect. Christ's peace must reign in your hearts. Since as members of the one body, you have been called to that peace. Dedicate yourself to thankfulness. Let the word of Christ, rich as it is, dwell in you. In wisdom made perfect, instruct and admonish one another. Sing gratefully to God from your hearts in psalms, hymns, and inspired songs. Whatever you do, whether it's speech or in action, in the name of the Lord Jesus. Give thanks to God the Father through him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
That you chose
as things that are a priority to you, it's important that we get a chance to kind of pull those things out and look at them on a day such as this. Now, you pulled an old piece of poetry out from the Old Testament, from the Song of Songs. It's one of these pieces of love poetry that was written for one of the princesses in the court of King Solomon. It's a piece, really, which is very idealized and very stylized, full of all sorts of what we would almost think of now as medieval imagery. But it's a piece that basically says, would you like to know how much I love you? Would you like to know how important you really are to me? And it runs then through that whole gamut of poetry that says, this is what it really is all about. That this is how important you are to me. That you really have the key to my heart. That you are allowed to walk through my heart anytime that you you are part of all that I am. That I think of you and all the beauty of the springtime around me. I think of you. And I think of your goodness. I think of your thoughtfulness. And I think of your beauty and your importance. When you pull all that business forward into our own situation as Christians, our own situation in the tradition which is ours as Catholics, the great image really of the love poetry of the Old Testament, the great image really of married love poetry, is the image of the cross. You know, the cross is supposed to say that to you and me all the time. The cross is, in a very real sense, you know, part of God's poetry. It's God saying to us, picture all the images of what love and sacrificial love is really all about. And he says, you picture the ones that mean the most to you, and let me tell you about one of mine. And he offers us the image of his own son giving his life for our salvation, breaking sin and death and selfishness and all the terrible things that hit our lives. You know, in a very real sense, that's exactly what your wedding bands were all about. You know, we bless those bands today as you make your vows. Every time you touch those wedding bands, every time you touch them across the years, they're supposed to bring back all of this poetry business. They're supposed to bring back all this realization of love. Of love that proves itself, you know, not just in idealized sort of in everyday sacrificial sort of things. You know, the cross, whether it's here at church, whether it's on the top of the tower, whether it's on the walls of our homes, wherever we see the cross really is God's wedding band. That's all it is. It's simply a sign and symbol of all of that. You picked, too, a little piece from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. It's a piece, really, that went to other brides and grooms, to other husbands and wives, to other brothers and sisters and loved ones and family and friends and children. Parents. It's the whole business, really. It's a family sort of reading. And it takes all the poetry and it says, okay, let's put that into everyday life. And that's why St. Paul says, when you deal with each other, he says, what's the hardest thing always to survive on? And he says, isn't it the extent, whether deep or thin, isn't it the extent of our patience? Isn't that the thing causes all the explosions? Isn't that the thing that ends up with us being irritable? Isn't that the thing that usually ends up with arguments? Isn't that the thing that usually pulls us into some sort of a selfish type thing? So St. Paul says, when you think about each other, he says, put on patience. He says, fill yourself totally with God's patience. And do it in everyday sorts of situations. One who would introduce the whole notion of swallow the angry words and don't say the words that are going to hurt. And he says, take the sting out of the things that we say and be mutually forgiving and patient with one another. And he says, be concerned then not with how many times you forgive each other, but be concerned only with how many more times can I keep on forgiving. Be concerned with that whole business then about how much do I need to give to you until it hurts. He says, be concerned with much God can give to you until it stops hurting. He says, all the everyday situations of life, he says, those are the pieces really that make the difference in married life. The pieces that make that married love that we idealize so in the poetry and in the romance, he says, those are the things that make married love an everyday sort of situation. It's that whole business about what can I do for you? What would you like to do? Is there any way I can go out of my way? Make things happier, more pleasant, more easy for you. business again about I'm sorry. It's the business of loving to the extent of being able to say, I made a mistake. And it's loving to the extent of being able to say, that's okay, forget about it. Let's work it out. It's all this business, you know, that makes everyday life. Without all the romance, without all, you know, the gauze to it. It's the very real sort of situation in every day. And Jesus said, the gospel piece that you chose today for us, somebody says, you know, my biggest interest is that you would love each other and that you would love God. He says, those are the big things. He says, that's really what I would like you to have. He says, because if you really love each other and if you really love God, he says, then your priorities aren't straight. And he says, I would like you to live my love. And I would like your love to be so, so great that it would fill your hearts with joy and that your hearts would be at peace. And he says, my interest is that your joy should be complete. Maybe today, as we ask God in such a very, very special way to watch over both of you, to watch over your family, maybe we really take all of those priorities, all of those values, the ideals and the romantic pieces and the down-to-earth pieces and the patience and the love and the peace and the joy, and see if you can't truly put them all in St. Paul has said, to wrap them around you, to let them rest over you just as the book of the scriptures rests over your head when we salute the gospel before and after we proclaim it. That all of God's love and God's patience and God's grace and God's joy might truly seep into your lives and into your hearts. And the sort of happiness which is yours this day might be a happiness that you can ever keep returning to every time you touch those wedding bands. We thank you for letting us be a part of this very special day. We ask two of you that you come forward now to witness those very special vows of yours. Brian and Cindy, you've come together here this afternoon at the Church of the Epiphany. Lord, may seal and strengthen your love in the presence of the church's minister and of this community of your family and friends. Christ Jesus abundantly blesses your love. He's already consecrated you both to baptism. And now he enriches and strengthens you by the special sacrament of matrimony, so that together you may assume the duties of marriage in mutual and lasting fidelity. So in the presence of the church and of all of us here who love you, I ask you once again to state your Brian and Cindy, have you come here freely and without reservation to give yourselves to each other in marriage?
Yes.
Yes. Brian and Cindy, do you love and honor each other as husband and wife for the rest of your lives? Brian and Cindy, will you always look upon your children as true gifts from God and bring them up according to the law of Christ and his church? Since it is your intention then to enter into marriage, I ask you with your hands joined to declare your consent now before God, before his church, before all of us here who love you. I, Brian, take you, Cindy.
I, Brian, take you,
to be my wife. I promise to be true to you. In good times and in bad. In sickness and in health. I will love you and honor you all the days of my life. And I, Cindy, so you have declared your consent before God, before his church, before all of us here who love you. May the Lord then in his goodness strengthen your consent and fill you both with his blessings. For when God has joined together, we must not divide. We ask you then to touch the rings. You know, the rings that you wear are signs of that love and that patience and that goodness and that sacrificial giving which marks the hearts of both of you. Every time you touch those rings, every time you wear them, may you always be mindful then of the mystery and the wonder that those rings stand for. And so may the Lord himself then bless these rings, which we bless in God's name. May he grant that you who wear them always have a deep faith in each other. That you ever do God, always live together in peace and in love. Amen.
Jesus, love me and all.
away the sins of the world. Happy are we who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Symbolizes the marriage of Christ and his bride, the Church. Father, by your plan, man and woman are united, and married life has been established as the one blessing that was not forfeited by original sin nor washed away in the flood. Look now with love upon this woman, your daughter Cindy, now joined to her husband, your son Brian, in marriage. She asks your blessing. Give her the grace of love and of peace. May she always follow the example of the holy women, praises are sung in the Scriptures. May your husband put his trust in her and recognize that she is his equal and the heir with him to the life of grace. May he always honor her and love her as Christ loves his bride, the Church. Father, keep them both always true to your commandments. Keep them faithful in marriage. Let them be living examples of Christian life. Give them the strength which comes from the gospel, so that they may be witnesses of Christ to others. Bless them through their children, and help them to be good parents. And may they live to see their children's children, and after a happy old age, grant them fullness of life with the saints in the kingdom of heaven. For we who love them ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And so, Brian and Cindy, may Almighty God, with his word of blessing, unite your hearts in a never-ending bond of pure love. May your children always bring you happiness. Generous love for them be returned to you many times over. May the peace of Christ live always in your hearts and in your home. May you have true friends to stand by you both in joy and in sorrow. May you be ready and willing to help and comfort all who come to you in need. blessings promised to the compassionate be yours in abundance. May you both find happiness and satisfaction in your work. May daily problems never cause you undue anxiety, nor the desire for earthly possessions dominate your lives. But may your heart's first desire be always the good things waiting for you in the life of heaven. May the Lord bless you with many happy years together, so that you may enjoy the rewards of a good life. And after you have served God loyally in his kingdom on earth, may he welcome you to his eternal kingdom in heaven. So may Almighty God then bless you this day and each, the Father, the Son, Mass is ended. Go. Peace and love the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, thank you.
Cameron's got something to say. I'm using the automatic focus.
Why? What do you mean you're losing it?
Just taking a class here and there.
Ready?
Okay, I'll talk to you on the
Zoom call in a minute. Once we start raining more, then.
Bring one for Tammy.
Well, see, I do that all the time.
Then if it's
but it was like, well, I need her to know when our important things are.
Yeah.
After that,
I haven't finished talking to me in like 3 weeks.
What do you feed your frogs? I know. Oh, yeah, what do you feed frogs?
Oh, no, they eat worms. I think they tear them apart.
You bought a frog? What kind of frog is it?
Hey Frisco. Hey Frisco. Hey Frisco. So we're at work here now, boy. Hey. There you go. And Brian.
Still work.
Yeah.
She's so protective of everyone she knows, especially when she gets out in the public.
Where is the doctor?
Let's go.
Here we go.
Run and come back out.
Whoa!
A little high. Jennifer. Here you go, Cam. What
do you say, Cameron?
What do you say, Cam? What do you say, Cameron? Whoa! A little inside. Okay. Whoa! I'll beat it up.
Okay, the count is 3-1. The start of pitching. The right. 3-2. Is that a strike up?
Come on, Tony. What do you say, Tony? Hang on, buddy.
Full count.
Oh,
away, Tony.
Come on.
There
you go,
buddy. Okay, we're at Lisa's, and this is the kitchen nook area and the family room. This is the kitchen, and that little box right there is the incubator, and in there are the duck eggs, which we'll look at later. And from the family room, there's the dining room.
And it's nice because you can lift off the top and clean out from the bottom.
Uh-huh. Here are my ducks.
And my kindergartners named them. The black one is Daffy and the yellow and brown one is Donald. Because Daffy Duck is black and Donald's sort of white.
That's Donald.
Donald and Daffy.
And Daffy. And these are my grand ducks. Grandkids ducks.
We don't know whether they're male or female yet, but in there for them to sleep in it warm. Mm-hmm. Because it's metal on the bottom, so mm-hmm. you're more comfortable for them. And they peck at it like they're trying to eat.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like,
you know, it's instinctive. Mm-hmm. It's in the water that's the, yeah, that's what. Amazing.
I'd say you ducks have a pretty good life. Living room.
And dining room.
And there's Brooke. Hi, Brooke. She just got up.
Come here, sweet boy. Do you like me? In your bikini?
I like your cat.
Where's Daddy? Daddy went by the park. Were we playing with the water balloons and the ducks? Yeah. We're running through the sprinkler.
Oh, we're going to see Brooke's room? Mm-hmm. Let me see your room, Brooke. Oh, that's a pretty room. What do you want to show me? Is that your bunny? This is a pretty room. Look at the nice things.
Wow, that's a very nice room.
Look at that.
You have a nice bed for your baby.
Mm-hmm. What's that?
Those are the O's on the chalkboard. My name is Brooke.
is bad.
Tell Uncle Pete, what's your baby's name that you got? What's her name? Beth. That's baby Beth.
That's a pretty baby. That's Beth.
Beth's actually my dad's. That it's for Dairy Realty, but he doesn't ever use it. I was the only one who used it when I worked there, yeah. So I've had it ever since I stopped working there and been in school.
Oh, well, this is Lisa's office.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. Studying to be a teacher.
Use word perfect.
And this is Paul's room. So big it would take a lot of time to get look at everything. What have we got here? Desk. Beds.
Ninja Turtles.
Where are they? Top of the bed. More Ninja Turtles. Private television set. T-ball certificate. Walk-in closet. Dartboard. All the clothes hung up very neat and nice. Shelf. Good gosh. Lucky boy. Nancy.
Look how much younger Stacy looks there.
Is that Lisa and Tony's wedding?
Day and
this is a master bedroom.
Unrehearsed narration.
A jacuzzi tub. Shower. Oreo. Hello, Oreo. That's Oreo. We're in the front. Tony's garage.
Shower. Lots of storage space.
Swim platform.
Yep.
Generator.
Okay, this is Abby's first trip on a boat. How do you like this boat, Abby? How do you like the boat, Abby? You like it? Now.
Your stove. Yeah. Popcorn. Oven.
Yeah, sun.
Sink. Everybody's beer bottles. Storage. Refrigerator. Ice maker. For your TV, and if you want to watch TV,
VCR,
yep, stereo, necessity, a liquor cabinet, trash compactor, washer dryer.
Microwave,
radar, VHF, autopilot, not speak, and work.
This is the smallest stateroom
here. Yep. Twin bunks.
Yep.
Sleeps two. That's port head.
Okay. This is a master stateroom.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The master head from the master stateroom. That's it.
Yep.
This is the Las Colette boat. No number.
Huh? Can you give me the number?
Going by Shady Oaks Marina, I guess. New grounding plate, scraping, sanding, painting, all needs to be compound and waxed. Jeep needs cleaning, oiling. Railing secured, no stress cracks. Scratches of fiberglass. Last year used was last year.
We've got some instrumentation missing. I don't know what it is.
I figured it out.
Okay.
It's the Lorraine, because the Lorraine's down there. No, it's secured there, so I don't know what this is. But the Lorraine's down there. 20 hours,
620 hours
on port and starboard. Poor visibility.
It's poor visibility sitting at the driver's seat. The driver's seat is back further than normal in the fly bridge. I'll point out there's no steering below also. The enclosure is well made, but it's not going to be around too much longer. It's pretty much deteriorated. That's the 110 circuit board.
And the 12 volt.
And 12, okay.
Kenwood stereo. Nice day in it.
forward stateroom. Upper and lower on the starboard side. Head and shower.
The engines are immaculate. The bilge is as clean as a whistle.
Now,
it's got a hell on. Both batteries are on off. Probably the bed.
We're looking down lot 49. This is owned by Linda, Susie, Cindy, and Mike, and Stacy. And the idea is to clear in approximately 25 or 30 feet so that I can take the tractor and cut it all the way down in a straight shot to meet the pond. Okay, the first shot was looking west on lot 49. Now we're looking east. I'm standing at the center of the new Stephen Lane. Okay, now we're looking west on lot 71, down towards the pond. Okay, now we're looking east along lot 71. That's the end of the rec area fence. The rec area continues about another 110 or 20 feet. We're going to clear all the way down along lot 71 and lot 49. This is how the pond exists now at the end of the fence. Just painting the area down to Palisades Drive. We've got a few of the khaki Campbell ducks resting and a couple of wild geese. And we're looking right down the fence line to Palisades Drive. The limits of the grass at the rec area. The rest of it, as we see, is all woods. Now we're looking north at the intersection of Palisades Drive and Lions Creek Road along the fence line of the pond. And this is the other side of Palisades Drive, looking north. This is where we're going to do the grading and seeding. That's showing four trees that we planted. That's Sean's, Tammy, Jacqueline, and Tony. Okay, now I'm looking south. I'm standing in front of Mike Buckingham's new house. That's where we're going to do some more grading and seeding down to the pond, to the grass part of the pond. And the same thing on the western side of Palisades Drive. The truck that's coming is the sand that's being used for the fill off of the undercut on the new road. And now I'm looking north again on the west side of Lions Creek Road, Palisades Drive, which will be also seeded and graded all the way up to Patuxent Court. Now at the center line of Palisades Drive, where it intersects Patuxent Court, showing the limits of seeding and grading. That's the corner right there with the dogwood tree in the background. And the mailbox down there is my lot and the entrance, which is already seeded. We're looking south on Stephen Lane, just at the turn, coming off of Palisades Drive. This is another area of undercut. The sand that we're dumping now has been taken from Skinner's Turn Road. They're mixing that with some of the dirt down by Palisades Drive, which is a little bit better. They're mixing it together. And of course that black screening is to prevent the sediment from getting into the groundwater. And from the same spot, looking south, toward Lions Creek Road. Now this is the pan that's bringing dirt from up nearer Palisades Drive. They're mixing this with the sand from Skinner's Turn Road. That pile of dirt to the left had been taken out of the road, all this. And that is actually very good topsoil. It looks good. We're going to save that until later. Now this is the mixing process. We're mixing both of them together. You see the two different colors of the dirt. This low area is between lot 66 and 43. Okay, we're in a dumping process now. We're looking west on Lions Creek Road.
Now you were still going down there first.
I don't think that.
I'll ask. How much you still have for you? Only about a third of that total, right?
It's probably about two. Probably about two thirds of what it is.
It's that much? It's not going to take much more.
Big stump and other heads for you.
Get down to the river.
Where she was too. You want everything right?
No, but I was the road to find.
I guess that she was too.
The brick wall? Yeah, I had two of them. Somebody ran into one. I took it down. It's sitting right there.
Really?
Yeah, right on the front side.
They ran right into it, huh?
They always run into it. Nobody admitted it, so I just took it down. I'll find someone like that. Right. Yeah, this has been hit too.
It's been hit too.
Oh yeah, man. Yeah, people come down here and they get drunk. This is where the stump used to be. We cleaned up part of the lot by the road. And now we're loading up the stumps from the pine trees. We removed all the shrubs in front of the house. They were getting too large and they were unsightly. He's clearing a spot now so that we can put Mike's boat and the minor line down there while he's doing the yard. The minor line, Mike's boat, which is in the way also. We just took down the pine tree in the front of my house. I mean the apple tree. I'm going to open that up a little bit back to this nice beech tree there. Been here for 12 years and finally taking it down. Been dead about five. And and Mike and I cut it down a few months ago. This is the lot 50 next to the pond. I'm going to extend this fence approximately 100 feet. There's no trees to take down except a few of these small ones in here. Further up, this area, there's no trees to take down at all. Maybe a couple at the most. Shrubs. And we're going to clear all the way up to